undeniable that we should be together. It's unbelievable how I used to say that I forever. The basis of need to know. If you don't know just how I feel, then let me show you now that I'm for real. If all things in time, time will reveal, yeah.
Well, listen, everyone. This is the moment we all been waiting for. Pastor Rodney and Samantha Cutter, they are better known to us as Pastor Roberson, me, Pastor Maxwell, as the Doctors of Love. If you guys have never experienced a session with them, get ready for what you're about to experience. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to some, I present to others, the Cutters. Everybody doing? All right. We've been exposed to some wonderful teaching over the course of the last 24 hours, and God has really richly blessed us. And I'm thankful today for Pastor Roberson and Sister Roberson, how they allowed us to open up this workshop, this time of impartation, from a very spiritual perspective to help us connect on that level. And I think it's important for all of us to understand that in order for us to be all that God would have us to be, that we have to continue, we have to solidify the triune being that we are. That is spirit, mind, and body. Without any of those things being out of place, your marriage will not be fulfilled. It's our purpose today to talk strictly about the body. You all have been blessed with everything else. Now it's our time to deal with you from the perspective of intimacy in the relationship, taking that intimacy to a whole nother level. How many of your intimacy level can be increased? Amen. Don't be ashamed. It's all good. If it doesn't need to be increased, you can leave now. But our purpose today is to take the religious barriers off of you, to allow you to go to a place in your relationship with your spouse to where you really reach the optimum, that level of togetherness, that level of unity where you experience that flow that Pastor Roberson was talking about last night, to where it's like everything you touch is blessed. When you walk in the door, it's blessed. Amen. When you eat dinner, you can barely eat dinner because you're so blessed. We want to take you to that place to where you experience ecstasy on a level where truly the anointing of God can only take you. Amen. How many of y'all want to go there?
Yes.
All right. Well, that's our hope today, is that you would let your barriers fall down and allow yourself to go with us on this little journey. Impact Marriage Ministries presents Reignite Sexual Healing. Are y'all ready?
Yes.
Amen. Well, we're ready to take you there. A few years ago, Pastor Maxwell introduced this idea to us, and he's already talked a little bit about that. And for some reason, the area of intimate relations became our part of this whole process. Now, I don't know what that, I think that might have stemmed from a a conversation that me and Pastor Robeson had when we was at a covenant fellowship many years ago. And those of you who know me know that I'm a pretty practical guy. I'm a practical joker from time to time. And when we went to the room, we was in the I think we was in the Hyatt, and they had this linen spray. It was my linen spray, but it wasn't my linen spray. It was the linen spray that was in the room. Somehow it came to be that I was attributed to having linen spray, and you have to ask him the rest of the story, but the reality of it all is that linen spray is something that that I like to use. I'm in the smells. That's just me. I like things smelling good. Everything.
All right.
Oh, we gonna go there, y'all. Y'all know we're gonna go there. And we gonna go there. See, God knew. He knew when He blessed me with my wife that I had to have a particular type of wife. And everything that was on my order, God gave it to me. And I'm thankful. I'm thankful. I tell her all the time, "You the sweetest." And God knew that. So God is so good. He's been good to me all of my life. So I just say that to say that it's important for you to understand the compatibility that you and your spouse have is something that was ordained by God from the very foundations of the earth. So you have exactly what you need. Matter of fact, I need you to look at your spouse right now and say, "Baby,
baby,
you are exactly
what I need."
So that will keep you from focusing on other things and other situations. It'll keep you focused on your home. So we're going to get into this process, and we're going to kind of lay out some ground rules, because I think it's important for us to establish ground rules whenever you're talking to a group of religious folks. And I'm not saying that in a negative sense. I'm saying that all of us, we are a product of our environments. And we learn certain inhibitions as a result of the environments in which we spend most of our socialization. In church, we learn that sex is bad,
all right.
But everybody's screwing.
Come on, stop.
Listen, y'all leave all the particulars for those other guys, but I'm going to tell you the straight up truth. The truth is, somebody's screwing somebody. And it's important for you to understand. And we put these little barriers on ourselves, but in real reality, we be in church thinking about it. Some of us. Not all of us, but some of us. So we have to understand that's a natural part of who we are. And what we tend to do is we tend to suppress that aspect of who we are, when really, when you're in a perfect marriage unit, God's ordained purpose for you is to explore the boundaries to there is none. To break the boundaries. So today, that's our objective, is to get you to break through the boundaries and experience ecstasy on a whole nother level. We talked about the different languages of love. We talked about agape love last night, the importance of us having an unconditional love for our spouse. And that's important. That's dealing with the spiritual aspect of who we are. We ought to reach each other on that level spiritually, to where we love each other unconditionally. This morning, we talked about the storge and the phileo aspect of love when we start talking about the mind. Talking about a brotherly love. I love you because I like you. That's dealing with the mind aspect of it. Storge dealing with the aspect of understanding that my love for you is a love that where I have an affection for you. I appreciate you. But this love that we're talking about today has to do with eros. And Maxwell kind of, I was like, "Russ, you're stepping in my area. Back out." But what we want to talk about is that aspect of love that most of us don't tend to think is a part of our religious makeup, and that is erotic love. I've heard it said, and you probably heard it said before as well, the bigger the Christian, the bigger the freak. The more anointed, the freakier the anointed one. So we're going to talk about how, and I see some of you already like, oh my Lord. But I think if you allow God to minister to you through this area, you're going to find that your spouse is going to look at you differently. He or she going to look at you and say, "You know what? ain't nothing wrong with being a little freaky sometimes. Amen. All right. So if y'all ready to go there, we can go there.
Let's go.
Now let me ask you a question. Who in here has never heard about linen spray? Be honest with me. Linen spray. Okay. All right. Too many of y'all ain't never heard about linen spray. There should be, let me deal with linen spray real quick. There should always be a residue that follows your time of intimacy with your spouse. There should be something that reminds them of you when you're not there.
Come on.
And see, this is the part of what my good friend didn't quite understand about linen spray. See, linen spray is something that you use to put because we all are sensory.
Right, come on.
You know, we all are made up of all these different senses, and certain things remind us of different things. When you smell a certain thing, it reminds you of food. Something should remind you of your encounter with your spouse in a sexual manner. Linen spray. Spray a little bit on the pillow before and a little bit after. And every time you walk through the house and they acting funny, spray a little linen spray in the air. Y'all heard of Pavlov's dog?
Yes.
When certain things trigger your senses, they ain't doing what they supposed to do, put a little linen spray in the air.
Right.
Watch what happens.
Come on.
Like an aphrodisiac.
Come on, God.
All right. So let's move. Again, I have my lovely assistant, Nurse Cutter. She is the doctor's assistant. Every good doctor needs a good assistant.
Come on, doc. Come on,
so we've been together now for 30 years, and over 30 years, been married for, this is our 25th year of marriage. So if we still have passion in our relationship, you should still have passion in yours.
Amen.
All right. So let's lay out some ground rules, because I don't want to be in a rush. I got to work through my little nerves, and once I get that done, we can move, all right? So we're going to move on. It's important for us to establish a biblical mandate or a biblical foundation to everything we do concerning the things of God and concerning being children of God. I don't want you to think that I'm just this little freaky pastor, which I am. I don't want you to think that that's all I am. I want you to understand that there's more to me than just the love doctor. I do read scripture. Now, in order for us to do what we have to do today and do it in a way in which it's going to be where you'll be able to leave this place and go do your homework for about 4 or 5 hours, it's important for us to establish a foundation on which to operate. Number one, the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:21, it says that we ought to prove all things, hold fast to that which is what?
Good.
All right. It says, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. Okay. Now, it's important for you to understand that this presentation is not designed to create in you a culture in your marriage that forces you to compromise your faith.
Right.
I don't want to say anything to you that will cause you to compromise who you are and what you believe as far as your faith is concerned.
Right.
So if something is offensive to you, I was taught this a long time ago. Eat the meat and throw away the bones. So if something is offensive to you, that doesn't mean that applies to you. You're not there yet. Or you may not ever get there. And that's cool. It's cool to be where you are and what you and who you are. But if you would allow what God has to say to us today to allow you to expand yourself, then you may enter into a place that you never thought was possible within the passionate realm of your relationship with your spouse. All right, so, but if I say something that offends you, the Bible says, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good for you. Now, if I say something you don't want to go all the way over there, you say, okay, I'm going to stay right here. This is as far, baby, don't listen to Pastor, this is as far as you want to go. My experience, because all of us are a product of our socialization.
Right.
There's certain things you encountered in your development that may be completely offensive to you based on your experience. And you need to be honest with your spouse about where you are in reference to that. Now, that's okay for them, but let's not let that come to our house. Or you might be on the other end of that saying, listen, he ain't went far enough. Which is cool. That's always okay, all right? All right, so my point today is to help break down some barriers that may have been limiting your ability to enjoy a blessed marriage. The second scripture is Hebrews 5 and 14, where it says, but strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So it's important for you to understand that this is about being a grown person. This is grown folk stuff. Okay, this is not for the weak at heart. This is not for those who are not quite ready to get to that place in their relationship with their spouse. This is about you being a mature adult. The Bible says even in 1 Corinthians 13 that when you was a child, you thought as a child. But when you became a man, you put away childish things. This is not for children.
Right.
This is for those of you who are ready to take your relationship to the next level. Are y'all ready?
Come on.
All right, the third one is Hebrews 13 and 4. Marriage is honorable. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge.
Yes.
You know, that is a very liberating scripture. And oftentimes we say the first part without including the second part.
Right.
That lets us know clearly that God ordained the sexual relations within the marriage to be both for procreation and sexual satisfaction or fulfillment.
Right, right.
The folks in the world should not be enjoying sex more than us.
Come on, God.
We should be setting the mandate and establishing the parameters for what a real marriage relationship looks like when it comes to sexual relations between a husband and a wife. They have perverted what God says was blessed. Many of us learn from the perverted perspective. So because we've learned from the perverted perspective, now that we're saved, we're like, okay, we can't do that anymore. We're saved. No, baby. I give you permission. As Paul said, now this is me giving you permission. Understand that you have the liberty for your bedroom to be a freak-filled zone. I had my little thing, but I can't put it on because I had a little Houdini coming up saying, the freaks come out at night. Freaks come out at night. Freaks come out. So that's what we should be about as believers. When you look at your spouse, even in worship, you should get caught up in the middle of worship and you see them worshiping God and you'd be like, because you know, if she is free to worship God that way. All right, let me move to the next one. Today we're talking about what? Sexual healing. Sexual healing is the ability to allow your God-given passions to create an environment of what kind of pleasure? Erotic pleasure that soothes, satisfies, and fulfills your most innate nature. It's not about being nasty. It's natural. And this is something even we learn as children. Because my son, it is something in our DNA. I'm exposing a little family secret. Something in our DNA, cutter men have this thing where they experience erotic fantasies early. And it's not that they was exposed to anything. It's just something. And it might just not be Cutterman. It might be Roberson men. I don't know. But I can remember my son. And y'all won't think, freaking, this is in my family. But it is. My son, at a very young age, about 3 or 4 years old, he shared with me. I'm giving all our family stuff. He shared with us. He said, Daddy, why is it that when my wee-wee touched the cover, it feel good. I say, son, you just wait a little longer. If you think that feel good, I wish I I had just one witness in here. And trust me now, what you do with that information determines his understanding of his own sexuality. If we would immediately go into this tirade and say, no, that's wrong, don't do that, it will teach him that what's natural is not normal. So we have to understand that, you know, even as little girls, your little daughters, and they touch themselves, and you see them touching themselves, and you're like, big, don't do that, don't touch yourself. You're teaching them that their bodies are nasty, and it shouldn't be touched. The reality is that's just a part of our natural makeup. That's who we are as God has created us. Certain parts of us bring pleasure. For a woman, stimulating her clitoris will bring about a sense of excitement. It's important for you to understand, and men, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but it's important for you to understand that certain things are just not nasty, they're just natural. Okay? So sexual healing is about bringing about a healing of your mindset, your understanding, that sex is not nasty. God created it and said, it's good. It's real good. And any man that maintains his integrity and his character within the confines of one woman, that's a superman.
Yes. Wow.
Because in men, we're stimulated by what we see.
Right.
And you know, like I know, there's them fine sisters are everywhere. Hallelujah. God knew what he was doing. And God gave us this sensory ability to be able to see things, and brothers love every real man. And we see a sister like, Lord, you made them hips. God, I thank you. You see a brother with hips, you like, that joke that is. Y'all gotta pray for me, y'all. I get in this morning, I go there, y'all. I spill with me. Say, Lord, y'all sing with me, say, Lord, please have mercy on him. I came close to cussing. That was not a word that was acceptable anymore, but nonetheless. So it's about understanding. It's about understanding who you are, and it's about understanding, you know, how God made you. God made you the way he made you for a reason, and for you not to suppress that, but for you to engage that. Alright? Alright, so understand this point, this next point. You were created to satisfy your spouse. Created. God pulled you out, formed you, just for that person that's sitting next to you.
Amen.
That person you came here with. God knew that that person would be the person that will cause you to fulfill his purpose for your life. And everything you need, they possess.
That's right.
Matter of fact, I want to do a little demonstration here. Stand up if you can stand up where you are and face your spouse. Just stand up and face him. Stand about a good foot from them and look at them from head to toe. Just look at them in the front from head to toe. Everything should match up, whether you're 6'5" or 4'2". Everything is created to match up. It's natural for you to be attracted to what's in front of you. This is what the world is trying to pervert. God created you to be a perfect, symmetrical match for each other. Now move a little closer.
Oh, yeah.
There you go, Pastor Jackson. You know what I'm talking about. You should get close enough to her, and some of us, you know, time has put something right there in the way called our belly. Hold it in for a second. I want you to get close enough to her to where her breasts touch your chest.
Tuck it up, Jill. Tuck it up.
Something in us that God put in us causes us, when we get our minds focused on who's in front of us, there should be some electricity that starts to take place as a result of the closeness that's generated from you being next to her. This is serious business. Now, don't play right now. I want you to connect right now. Because you already connected last night spiritually. Yeah. And you connected this morning cognitively and emotionally and mentally. Now I want you to connect physically. Do me a favor. I want you to rub each other's shoulders. Go down to the back. Go down to the lower hip, the lower back. And this is for those of you who can actually go there. And this is the only demonstration today. Grab her on her hips. Say to her, "These are my hips. And I thank God for them." Alright now, y'all break it up. Because I don't want you to take your seats. I want you to understand that you were created. I want you to understand that you were created by God. Listen, all the blemishes, all the imperfections, all the additions that's happened over the years, the more there, the more the love. All of that was created just for you to enjoy heaven on earth. It's important for you to understand that you were created to satisfy your spouse. There should never be a time when you deprive your spouse of the ability to be satisfied by you. The Bible says in Genesis 1:27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. God is so good, y'all. Amen. Oh, God is good. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 7:3 and 5, it says the husband should fulfill his wife's sexual needs, and the wife should fulfill her husband's needs. The wife gives authority over her body to her husband, and the husband gives authority of his body to his wife. Do not deprive each other of sexual relations unless you both agree to refrain from sexual intimacy for a limited time.
Come on.
So you can give yourselves more completely to prayer. Afterwards. Y'all say afterwards.
Afterwards.
There has to be an afterwards.
Right.
Amen. Like Gina was in the spirit, reading and speaking in tongues, and her husband came home, "Look, I laid this out for you." And she's like, "No, baby, we got to pray." We can pray during. Afterwards, you should come together again so that Satan won't be able to tempt you because of your lack of self-control. My next point is stay sexy, girl. Look at your wife and say, "Stay sexy, girl. Stay sexy, girl." Now listen, y'all have to work with me. And my sister, she's going to come in just a minute. But I think it's important for you to understand that I'm learning how to use PowerPoint. This is something new for me. So stay sexy, girl. Stay sexy. Stay sexy. It's important for you to maintain a positive attitude, woman of God. Your attitude makes the difference on how that man views you. It allows you to either cause that man to lose interest, become mundane, or it allows him to be excited about seeing you. You got to maintain a positive attitude. Confidence is sexy. Have you ever, and let's be honest here, all of us have different levels of beauty. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Amen?
Amen.
So all of us have different levels of beauty, what it is that attracts us. But we can all agree that a woman, though not as attractive as the next, can find herself getting a lot of attention just based on her attitude. You don't have to be the most natural, beautiful person in the world. If you believe that you're beautiful and you carry yourself like you're beautiful, somebody don't notice you. The purpose of it is not to get noticed outside, but to keep your husband's attention. So you gotta have a positive attitude. Don't view yourself in light of other women. Something about you attracted that man. And it's your responsibility to maintain a positive attitude to keep him attentive to only you. It's important to maintain a healthy diet and exercise. Now, I'm the last to talk about this, but I'm the first to advocate. It's important for you and I to understand that you have to be on a regular routine to keep yourself in check, especially after you get 40. Amen. Especially after you get 40. Walk every now and then. Exercise. For the women, it's important for you to maintain yourself. Yeah, we know after you have children, it's hard to keep that high school figure. But do your best to maintain a healthy lifestyle. Watch what you eat. When you get over a certain age level, you got to maintain a proper diet. You can't eat like you're 20 all your life. You got to be mindful of that. And every now and then, go for a walk. Encourage him to go walking with you. Women, you got to give him something to look at. Remember, I said sexiness is confidence in your attitude, your disposition. Give him something to look at. It's the little things you do that makes the difference. Make sure you get your nails done, your hair done. Get that brother something to look at. Don't take it all to the office and leave it there. Don't take it to the job and leave it there. Dress up for him. He would appreciate it. The last thing he want to see is tore up nails when the girls at the job got tight nails, got their hair done. And some things, budget limitations, it's tough times now. Get in the mirror, get you some, you know, straightening comb and straighten that stuff out. Or if you're going to go natural, keep it neat.
I want to add something to the first part. Maintain a positive attitude. Confidence is sexy. And sexy is not determined by what size you are. Mm-hmm. Sexy doesn't have to always be a 3. It doesn't always have to be a 12. Sexy is not determined by what size and the shape of your figure. Sexy is confidence. Loving yourself just for who you are and how God made you. Don't be measuring yourself up against someone else and determining that you know they're better than me. You have to do you and do you well. Know what appropriately fits your body type.
Amen.
Because they made it in the 12 and they go all the way up to 22, you might not need to go there. Know what's appropriate. Look at yourself. Examine your body. Size yourself up and know. Try on things that you look at from a hanger. So, you know, I don't know. But if you try it on and try to work with it, there's this thing now they got called layering. And you can add accessories. Those things are made for us. We don't just get some big old dress and just put it on and go like that. You got to accessorize. And just like we accessorize ourselves physically to look good, we have to accessorize in our relationships. Bring something new to the table. Try something new. You have to know what you need and do what's good for you. Maintaining a healthy diet and exercise. Fruits and vegetables are great. Lean proteins. Those are good things to help keep your body in check. We had an awesome buffet on last evening. All of the seafood. Those items are good, and they're actually good for aphrodisiacs. I looked when we got back to the room, I said, you know what? We had a table full of aphrodisiacs, the oysters, the shrimp, anything that's a shellfish, lobster, crabs, all of that. Get your body in tune to want to have a pleasurable moment. That increases your libido. Doing exercise, getting a regular routine. Doesn't have to be every day, but every other day. Whatever it is that you do. Exercise relieves stress. And on the other hand, it produces endorphins. And endorphins are getting your body ready for some other activities that your body will enjoy. So as you're reducing stress, on one hand, it's getting you ready for an environment. On the other hand, endorphins are also produced by the pituitary and the hypothalamus during exercise. So as you're exercising, getting all sweaty, hot and bothered, you know, think about it on the other end. As you're producing those endorphins, you're also getting your mind ready for a sexual encounter. Because those are being produced, those hormones are being produced whether you know it or not. So once you get through with your exercise, any type of excitement activity, anything that has to do with pain, spicy foods are also producing endorphins. You ever ate a hot chili pepper and wanted to get home real quick? I thought about that thing. Yeah. I said, you know, I love spicy food.
I love that she loves spicy food.
I got to have hot sauce on everything. And it clicked. We look at each other and I said, you know what? Wow. My sisters know I got to have jalapeno peppers on everything. I got to have those little crushed red peppers on everything. Everything I eat is spicy. So now I know the connection.
And listen, also too, keep in mind that she was sharing earlier about shellfish, the importance of having shellfish in your diet, because it does release certain types of hormones and things in your brain that allows you to go to the erotic side of who you are. So you need to have a oyster night, shellfish night, just shrimp. Last night, y'all should have got y'all freak on after last night. I mean, really, because it does do something to your body. It causes your body to go to another place. Lean meats. It's important to have lean meats in your diet. Fruits and vegetables. Those things help clear your bloodstream and prepare your body for sexual engagement. God made us that way. And when we take in the proper things, then we'll find that our sex drive will increase. And men, as you get older, you know that your sex drive starts going down. So you have to do things to supplement that. And it ain't always Cialis and those other drugs that have you in the middle of the night with your eyes wide. Okay. You go crazy. I have you so wide up you can hardly survive. Okay. Having heart palpitations in the middle of the experience, you got to be rushed to the emergency room. So it's important for you not to use all those supplemental things. Now, it's a time when that's necessary, and you need to use it. But if you have a good diet, it's rich in those things we've mentioned, those shellfish items and fresh vegetables, you'll find yourself in protein, lean protein, you'll find yourself in a more prepared manner when it comes time for your engagement with your spouse. All right, it's important also, ladies, to every now and then, and I'm talking about getting your sexy on here, it's also important for you to put on something or take off everything. I mean, one of the things that we tend to do after we're married for a while, and I understand the children, you got to be mindful of the children and walk softly around the children, but the children, their stamina shouldn't be as strong as yours when it comes to staying up at night. There comes a time when they get tired. And the key thing is, don't get them up in the morning to go to school at the last minute. Get them up an hour early. I'm trying to help y'all. Get them up an hour early. Have them do stuff around the house. Clean up their room. Get them moving early so by the time they come home, they're tired. Now, hey, listen. Get them off the computer. Let them get 30, 45 minutes outside running around in the circle. Let them get that energy off so around 8 o'clock, you can start shutting the house down. 9 o'clock, you could be taking care of engaging your spouse. 10 o'clock, you could be asleep. But what we do, we get them up at the last minute, rush them on the bus, let them come home, let them take a nap. That's the worst thing you can do. Let them take a nap. And the other point that I was making is that, put on a teddy, but nothing else. Let me talk to y'all then. Put on a 90. Lady, it doesn't.
What's a teddy? What's a teddy?
Oh, come on.
Teddy bear.
Teddy It says a different word? Oh, they got a new, what's the new word?
Negligee.
Okay, I'm old school, okay? Camisole. Y'all remember the time of camisoles? Y'all, some of y'all old school camisoles. That means, just, you know, just, it's not a bra, but it just covers your breasts and that's it. Okay, all right. That's all a brother wants. We're visual. A corset. Thank you, a corset. But this is what I want you not to do. Take off those sweatpants. Unless it's that time. If it's that time, that's an indication to the slow brothers that this, you know, the store is closed for a few days. Come back when the sign is out. That's what that's for. You know, and again, you know, every now and then, we are visual, and there's certain things that attract certain people. I like big girls. I like, you know, my wife. I like, you know, nice sized women. Woman. It's important. You know, there's certain things that you should wear, and there's certain things you shouldn't wear. Certain things you should wear at home that you don't wear in public. But what we've got a culture of now is folks wearing stuff in public that they should only wear at home. You know, there's certain things, big girls, that you shouldn't try. Stay in your lane. And then there's certain things little girls wish they could wear that they can't wear. Stay in your lane. Everybody got a lane. Stay in it. And that's important. It's important. It's important for you to give your spouse, you know, they married you. They love you. They want to experience all of you. And they want you to be confident in your skin. So it's important for you every now and then just to get, just go back to Eden. Live on top of the world. I mean, it's every now and then you need to be in an environment, in a situation to where y'all can just be free. And free indeed. To where ain't nothing, you know, nothing matters. Okay? So it's important to take everything off sometime. Alright? Brothers, it's important for you to keep your game tight. Ladies, look at your man. Look at your man and say, keep your game tight, bro. Keep your game. See, but I was talking about PowerPoint. I was saying I wanted to be able to bring the bullets up, but I couldn't figure that all out. That's all right. We can all read it all together. Don't stop dating her. Ladies like to be romanced. And you are, hey, I'm not romantic. Yes, you are. You got her. You did some things to get her. What you start, you got to finish. You got to finish it. So it's important for you to keep dating your wife. Date her. Take her out. Send her gifts. Buy some flowers every now and then other than Valentine's. Show up on the job and just have, you know, a bouquet of flowers for her. Let her know you appreciate who she is. Okay? And wash, man. Look at another brother. Bro, look at another brother. Say, man, wash, please. You. Wash, man, and wash often. You can't work all day and just jump in the bed and then start rubbing on her. I'm trying to, listen, it's important for you to understand that you just can't come from playing 18 holes of golf and take your stuff off and can I get something to eat? You eat something and then you like, hey girl. No, you smell like what you just been doing for the last 8 hours. Women love a man that smells good. Yes. Oh, y'all don't? Yes. I better stay standing. Hygiene is important. If you're the type of man that don't like cologne, I understand that. Get you some body oil. Try that. Because ladies, trust me, when they smell a good man, and it ain't you, they let them know. Ooh, you smell good. Now, they ain't gonna let you hear them say that. But they do compliment men that smell good. So don't say, oh, my wife ain't into all of that. Yes, she is. Don't let her fool you. I hear it all the time. I hear it all the time. So trust me, they like a good smelling man. So you be her good smelling man. Next thing, cut your nails, big bro. Bruh, cut your nails. You remember I was telling you earlier about how a woman loves to be touched. They love to be caressed. They love to be held. And the last thing they need is for you to come into bed like Grizzly Adams.
Come here, girl. Let me scratch you down.
Don't touch me. Has she ever told you, no. That hurt. But I'm serious, because your fingernails need to be manicured. Women, brothers, look at your hands. What you think is a gift that you think you possess may not be your greatest gift. Your hands might be your greatest gifts to accent what you have. Because you think you all of that?
You big daddy, I'm big daddy.
You think you all of that? Like I said with y'all a few years ago, go there and watch your wife have a baby. You'll see how big daddy you are. Things happen to that thing that you can't never.
I told that thing I know you did.
She just got you believing you told her. If she had a baby before, you ain't nothing. A baby not came through death. So you gotta use what you have. You gotta use what you have. God gifted you with a good set of hands. And your hands used in a certain manipulative ways where your fingernails aren't in a place to where they, you know, some of y'all cute brothers got them old long nails, y'all ain't doing nothing. Because the hands in the hands of a man that know how to use, it's just like my daddy said, tools in the hand of a man that know how to use tools is a master, an artist. Use your hands. You'll be surprised if you start using your hands. You'll be like, every now and then I got this little thing, I'll just say, I'm just gonna keep it real as fucking people. When she start, listen, and this is true. When she start acting up, and we be around the house, and I was like, babe, can you give me something to drink? I'm in the middle of something. I said, can you give me something? What you want to drink? Tell some brother, say, cut your nails, man. And listen, I want to bless somebody right now, and I just need a sister. Just be honest with me. You know your man need a set of nail clippers. Raise your hand real high. Quick. You ain't going to embarrass him. All your brothers, y'all got your stuff tight like that? Well, can I bless somebody? What brother want to take care of their hands today?
We'll take it.
Who said? Thank you. Thank you, bro. Ain't no shame. I like that, bro. Ain't no shame in it. Because I got me a set that I keep with me.
The key with that file that he gave you, it has, I believe, 7 sides to it. And each side serves a purpose. We just can go to get the regular emery board. It doesn't have the particular shine, the buff, smooth. This works wonders. Every now and then I'll be, you know, just going about my business. I'll see him over in the corner. I already know what time it's going to be. I already he has a massage chair in the room. He's quiet, got his beats on, and he's just filing. I said, what you doing? He's filing my nails. I already know. Bless you.
No, but we can make sure you get hooked up. That's for sure. So it's important. It's important for you to be properly, your hygiene. That includes your hygiene. keeping your nails done. Brothers, please cut your toenails. I bet you right now, a lot of those sisters right now, they can't even wear stockings. Because you done cut the side of their leg off. From toenails that's just too long. Cut your toenails. It's important, and this is for the men. And I know I talked with the ladies about exercise. Men, please, every now and then, go for a walk, go for a run, you know, do something, exercise. Because what exercise does, like my wife said earlier, it releases certain endorphins and allows you to reduce stress. It helps you reduce stress. And it's important for you to maintain a proper and healthy sexual relationship with your wife where you're not stressed out trying to perform sexually. Because what you find yourself doing then is you using... I want to say it, but you can't beat the coochie up and get your stress out. You can't. Every time, listen, and this is important. Every time you got to be a roughneck, every time you hood, I'm hood. Somebody, what is wrong with you? And your frequency might be related to every time you get in it, you beating it up. Your lack of frequency. Because you're like, listen, I don't feel like fighting you every time we have this. Make love to me. Quit messing you. The other word is vulgar. Don't do that every... That's been your experience? I need you to love me tenderly. Not beat me up and bruise my body. You taking all your stress out on me when I want you to love me.
Oh God.
Now there's certain times when she wants you to be hood man. You be gangster. Yeah. Come on, bring the gangster tonight. Okay? But don't bring gangster every time. It's important. Listen, y'all laughing, but I'm being serious. It's important for you to have encounters where you're not just being gangster all the time. There are times when she just wants you to just, as they call it, quiet vagina. There are times when she just wants you to be in it. And you don't feel the need to have to be. There are times when intimacy happens when you're in there and you're man enough to stay in there and just stay in there.
Intimacy.
It's important for you to understand what intimacy really means. It means that you need to see in me. And being able to see in me requires you to understand, take time to love me before you make love to me. Take time to love me. Don't be in such a rush to get to the point to where you're on the mountain. No. Take time to love me. Let it not always be about you getting your climax. Let it be about us connecting, because the optimum fulfillment of you being what God wants you to be is when you're there together. And you see her getting there. And you're like, okay, yeah, we're getting close. Oh, woo! And y'all there together. And not just about you.
Let's keep in mind that love making is an art. Does everyone draw the same? Does everyone paint the same? You can create your own pretty picture in your own way. You have to be unique. What works for you, works for you. Paint your own love picture. Think about that the next time you have an encounter. What does our picture look like? What does our intimacy look like?
What does it really look like?
On a
On the canvas.
On the canvas.
Yeah.
What did we create?
Is it a pretty picture? Or is it a bunch of stuff everywhere?
Amen. Amen.
Consider my needs first, sometime.
Always want to have it your way. It's only about me to roll over and go to sleep. Don't even ask. No touch. No kissing. When was the last time you really, really, really got a good kiss? Really? Really?
Really?
Not just a peck.
Come on.
See you later. No, a was real
the last
tongue
time you
involved.
Kissed was when you got married?
And really felt it when you kissed.
See, you have to understand the power of kissing. Something is released when you kiss.
Exactly.
And when you kiss passionately. There's certain nerve endings that are excited as a result of the time you spend kissing. It's like 1,000 times more
in your fingers.
Than your fingers in your hand.
Your finger prick. That feeling you feel is so sharp. Your lips are sharper than that.
And when you connect like yes. that, yes. certain things are released from your lips, your mouth, your saliva when it connects. And it creates that. If you notice, if you ever really passionately kissed your spouse,
that's right.
all of a sudden you'd be, ooh, shoot. you feel, you're like, ooh.
What it does, it suppresses cortisol in your brain. And cortisol is a conscious awareness of what's going on. So you get involved in kissing, and you get, you know, you kiss, and you the longer it lasts, your brain shuts out. You know what? Did I shut the door? Did I cut the pot off? Your brain shuts out all of that. It goes way beyond that.
Exactly.
It cuts off the reasoning, as they say. I think they said the reasoning part of you. It's almost like you get caught up in that world of kissing to where nothing else matters.
And that's why it's important, even as you train your children, the importance of them kissing or restraining from kissing. Because kissing is just like the doorway to everything
exactly.
else. If you kiss passionately, then you remember when y'all used to really French kiss? You remember that? And how that always led to something else? Before long, your hands start moving. And everything started connecting and gelling. It's because there's power when you exchange to someone in kissing. So keep that in mind. That's why sometimes a gentle kiss and a soft touch may be all that you really need that night. May not need anything else. I'm talking about developing intimacy. There are times when you, as a man, that you know, you need to just say, you know what, I'm just gonna hold her. She needs to be held. There are times when my wife, she's just come to me and just say, hold me. I'm like, oh Lord, I know what this means. This means that I haven't been holding her as much as I should have. And it reminds me of my need to just hold her without any type of sexual expectation being placed on that moment. There are times where we need to connect and connect in a way spiritually and physically to where sex is not the optimum objective.
Exactly.
When you express yourself that way to each other, you'll find those times, especially when your wife is or your spouse is restraining from you, when you show true concern and genuine care, it often leaves the doorway to you going somewhere else. Don't manipulate them, though. Be honest and true about where you are with that. And spend time holding each other. Brothers, we don't know. If I'm going to hold you, No, there are times when you just need to hold. The Maxwells touched on this real heavy earlier, so we're not going to spend a whole lot of time here. The importance of communication in your relationship. Communication, talking eliminates tension. Tell me what you like. Don't just assume I know. And this is important as you continue to develop your relationship with your spouse, as you grow time into the relationship, there are times when you need to just tell them, okay, baby, this is what I want. There needs to be nights where you just all sit around the table and say, you know what? This is what I'm going to do to you. Would you like that? Let me get these children taken care of. That's what you got on your mind? Talking. Where do we assume our spouses know what makes us feel good? Think about about it from this perspective, the example the Maxwells gave, none of us came from the same environments. Even sitting at our tables, we had different ideas about those various words. Sex, having relationship with your spouse, they need to know. You need to know what makes them feel good. Just because they make noise don't mean it feels good. Or that's what they want right then. There are times when you need to just honestly have a conversation about what it is you like and what you don't like. Don't assume they know. And I found that the freer the communication, the more fulfilling the experience. When there's no inhibitions in your relationship, when you're able to tell each other freely, baby, this is what, you know, do this, do that. Yeah, oh, you? That's what I'm talking about. It creates an environment to where there's no taboo in your relationship because you're free to share. No, no, baby, no, no, don't do that. Don't, no, no, I don't like it when you do that. Mm-mm. It's important for you to share that with one another. And as you become more freer in your relationship with each other, you'll find that takes away room for errors. Have y'all ever been in the middle of something and she's like, uh-uh. That was an error. That was an error. Now, if we could transition here, because I know our time is getting short, but I wanted to kind of cover a few more things that's important, and then we got a few gifts we want to give out. Your body is my body, and my body is your body. Look at your spouse and say, your body is my body. My body is your body. And being that your body is my body and my body is your body, we need to establish a 3-day rule. Because men have a 3-day attention span. After 3 days, that brother looking for something. You see him rubbing up against the door seal. Every 3 days, if you see him acting like he's marking his territory, every 3 days, that brother got the release. That's just the way we're made up. We're made up different. Y'all women, y'all can just go, I'm fine. But us brothers, after 3 days, after 3 days, it's like, something had to happen. Because what happens is, after 3 days, our attention stops focusing on other areas. And we get distracted easy. We're distracted a lot easier than you all are. So there need to be at least 2 encounters a week. At least 2. I prefer every day. I would encourage you to do it every day. The more you do it, the less issues you will have in your relationship. But there needs to be at least a 2 times a week rule. And every experience don't have to be a marathon. Every experience, you ain't got to jump off the top rope. Swing from the ceiling thing. I don't know about other brothers, but every now and then, a quickie is cool. Y'all looking crazy right now. Go ahead, Smitty.
No, it's been said, the more often a man releases, the healthier his prostate.
I just went to the doctor and the doctor said, you got a good prostate.
Really good. And it's been said that every day that there are 120 million people having sexual experiences. Every day. Think about that. Every day somebody's having sex. Not just one, 120 million people.
Are you in the number? Are you in the number? You know, single people want to have sex. Married people aren't having enough sex. You got license.
Wow.
You got permission.
Wow.
And you're restraining.
Yes.
Wow.
Because of, get those 2 areas right. Spiritual, emotional, mental. Sex should just be free in your home. Your kids should always be like, what y'all, quit kissing. Quit holding. Put some clothes on. Your body, my body, my body. Can I teach you? Can this is what the Bible says. The Bible says your breasts are like fawns, twins of a gazelle, grazing among the first fruit flowers. The sweet, fragrant curves of your body, the soft, spice contours of your flesh. Invite me and I'll come. I stay there until dawn breathes light and night slips away. Solomon was a bad man. Proverbs 5:18-19 says, let thy fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. Let her be as a loving hind and a pleasant roe. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times, and be thou ravished always with her love.
Come on, cut.
She was created for you. You were created for him. Her breasts are a gift from God. You should never get Wayne. Weaned. Her breasts are a gift. She like you being on them, and you like to be on them. So, Solomon said, listen, I'll take care of you if you want to be taken care of. I'm not being nasty, I'm just being biblical. Okay? Her request, this is her request to Solomon. Solomon 4:16. Wake up, north wind. Get moving, south wind. Breathe on my garden. She ain't talking about something outside. She said, breathe on my garden. Fill the air with spice fragrance. Hallelujah. Oh, let my lover enter into his garden. Yes, let him eat the fine, ripe fruits. She tells Solomon, she said, look here. I want the wind to blow on me. Because I'm hot for you. And I want you to sense what I got for you before you get it. Carry this fragrance to him. That I smell. Talk to me here. Matter of fact, bro, here. Bless you, man. You know what to deal with. You got the fingernail file and the spray. You get to know, son. We won't see y'all no more this weekend. Eat the frying ripe fruit. Now I can't stop there, y'all, because I got to get on out of here because my time is up. Our time is up. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's get to a little nasty. His response to her request, I went to my garden, dear friend, best lover, breathe the sweet fragrance. He said, I smelt it. After I smelt it, I ate the fruit and the honey. I even drank the nectar and the wine. Somebody need to celebrate. Raise your glasses, baby. Every time you encounter your spouse, there should be a time when you say, now, I ain't physically able to do that every day, but Lord, thank you. Make you go back to smoking, then. No, if that didn't make you go back, this gonna make you go back. Add a little gas to the fire. You're already on fire. But add a little gas. Gas is accoutrements. Y'all might call it accoutrements. Accoutrements are small items that can communicate special care and attention for your lover. Now, we've gotten to a place now to where you no longer have to go to the little nasty store to get accoutrements.
CVS.
CVS. Walgreens, Walmart, Dollar General, Family Dollar, all sell accoutrements. You just got to be creative in your ability to use the accoutrements. Now, this here accoutrements is one that you can find anywhere. This is a date night. Who has been on? Who this is your first time? First time here. First time here.
Yes.
First time here. The newlyweds. This here is what they call, this can turn a dinner into an unforgettable evening. Yours and mine. This ain't just for me. This for you too. His excites, hers delights. Together, they will ignite. So accoutrements are small items that can communicate special care for and attention to your lover. Warming gels, oils, scented condoms, hand massagers, feathers, paddles, whips, chains, cuffs! Alright, that might be a little too much. You want those last couple of them, because y'all saying, I don't know what y'all have, you know. Let's change things. This year, I'm going to give this to, who's the oldest couple here this weekend? No, I don't want to embarrass my people. But I want to embarrass y'all. Because y'all got children. Y'all know what's going on. This here is warming jelly. Warming jelly. This is not edible, so don't get sick. I'm gonna do this. Because this here for folk who hang from chandeliers and stuff. This here, I'm gonna give y'all that. That'll be a blessing to y'all. That's kind of sick. You know what I'm saying? But I know there's some real freaky Christians in here. That's why I was waiting on that. All right. Hand massages, scented oil, condoms, feathers, paddles, things that awaken your senses. Okay? The purpose is to heighten and awaken your senses. It's not to embarrass you. It's to allow you to experience ecstasy on another level, to take it over the top, to allow you to say, woo! Thank you, Jesus. It's to get you to celebrate who God is and all that he's done. This here kissable sensation, you were singing to your man last night, and I want to give you an opportunity to redeem yourself. You had like a Kirk Franklin spirit on you, and you started talking, singing, and started singing. You will sing. After that, you will sing. You will sing. You will sing. You will sing and celebrate unto the Lord. You will. 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 This is just to add a little gas to the fire. Now understand this, because I don't want you all to go to a whole nother freaky level and then be like, Pastor Cutter said it was okay for us to do what we wanted to. I told you, baby, we should have been able to bring these things into the bedroom. Some of y'all, because of y'all experiences and because these things y'all did in the world were not, it was completely perverted. You can't bring those things into the bedroom.
Come on, cut.
You got to plead the blood of Christ that God will cleanse you and cleanse your spirit of that freaky stuff that you used to do that did not bring glory to God. And now you have this nice little reserved partner who wants to love you, and they can't love you because every time you go into the bedroom, you got to come in there and got this whole big old back sack with you talking about, come on, baby, we about to do this. Are we going to do this or not? And they're like, we can't do that. You got too many toys in there. Put your toys up and make love to me and quit trying to screw me. You screwed them. I don't want you screwing me. When we connect, I want you to make love to me. I don't want you to screw me. So there's some things you need to leave outside. So what are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying it's okay to add accoutrements to your relationship, but don't take them to the point to where your partner is offended by your accoutrements. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Y'all hold on just a second. Let me get my slideshow back up. That's it right there. All right. Accoutrements. There should never be an accoutrement that you bring to your relationship in your bedroom that is offensive to your partner. That's why you got to communicate to them. Baby, is it okay? I don't know about that. Can we try? In trying it, no. Throw it away. Warm in jail, I don't care what it is. Throw it away. Whatever you bring should be nothing of a deviant nature or use. Should not change the use of what's already natural. It should enhance. It should enhance. And it's important that you enhance your experiences, not substitute. Don't be scrapping nothing on, talking about, okay, my turn. No. No, you don't get no turn like that. Whatever the accoutrement is, it must always communicate your love in a new and exciting way. It should never substitute your love. It should enhance your love. All right? All right. Now, I think it's important that I sow these other gifts to the lives of some very important people. Amen. Some of y'all nervous tonight. There you are. I'm dying. I want to make sure this gets all the way back to the Potter's house. What that is, brother, what that is some massage oil, and the purpose is to apply it gently to your spouse and allow her to experience what your hands feel like. All right? Now, once she gets finished being massaged, now it's your job, Sister Williams, to reciprocate, because we believe in reciprocation. It's important to reciprocate in every relationship. Just like your spiritual relationship, God reciprocates back to us. It's our responsibility to reciprocate to each other. Okay? Now, I got one more gift I want to give away, and this is some linen spray that I have to sow into the life of my friend, Pastor Robertson, because he had a bad experience with linen spray in the past, and I want to erase that from his memory and allow him to experience in a whole new and exciting way. Right? One more gift and we're done, and this is to be sown into the lives of our visiting pastor, Pastor Jackson, his wife's desire to have more children. Let me finish. You premature shouting. I believe that was a total aberration. Because I can just read my brothers like, this woman, I love her, but she is crazy. And she think we're going to break more children. This is a blessing to you.
Amen.
Don't be such a blessing to us.
Thank you
so much. Thank you so much. And as always, the visionaries of this ministry, we have gift for them, and we will make sure they get that. If they don't show up tonight to the party, understand that they are. What we want to do now is it's 11:35. It's 12:35? Wow. Okay, all right. Listen, we want to thank God for you for just the little time we had to share with you today. And we want to open it up for about 2 or 3 questions, and then we want to close out real quick. So can we do that, about 2 questions? We don't have time? All right, we'll have to do that later on today. Well, listen, grab your spouse's hand. wife and your husband? These are some questions you can think about as we pray. Because these are questions that most Christians won't ask us to, and they're like, where have they found? Talk to me, I can give you some scripture to kind of help you out. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for blessing us over the time that we've had together today, as well as last night. Father, you knew when you made us that you made us spirit, mind, and body. Spirit, soul, and body. Father, when those three elements are working in harmony, we have a picture of what's going on in heaven. Our marriages can either be hell on earth or they can be heaven on earth. My prayer is somehow in the course of the time we've had together that we've been able to interject some things to help make our marriages just a little bit more heavenly. Father, I thank you. I bless you for every relationship here. Those that are even having relationship struggles in the area of sexual togetherness, struggling with just being free to each other. I bind the enemy who will pervert our marriages. I bind the enemy of pornography. I bind the enemy of internet sites that will lead us astray. I bind the enemy of infidelity that will cause us to stray after something other than what we really need. What we need is what we already have. Help us, God, to look into our spouses and see the greater purpose you have us being together really means. And Father, for those times where we're physically unable to hold up our end intimately, help us, God, to just understand that being there and being close and talking through those times of difficulty will bring about a sense of healing. It's not always about the inner course. Sometimes it's about the outer course. Help us to remember that you have ordained us to be together. And God, you will keep us. Bless these marriages. Bless these, your people. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you all. And God.
Dream come true. Just wanna be with you. Girl, it's plain to see you're the only one for me. Repeat steps 1 through 3. Make you fall in love with me. If ever I believe my work is done.